to the given topic for me is about splines. So I more of a generalized it to a topic of curves. So I think what it is spline is a alteration of what is called curve. So myself is Ram Kumar. I think Hina has been given about me in the introduction. So let us see about curves. So as a technical person, as an engineer, so we should know first why we are doing it. So the why comes from the need. So what's the need to do, or what's the need of a curve in our CAD/CAM? So the first agenda of my presentation is about why, what is the need, so which application has created the need for it. So we'll see that in a quick way. So then the basic about curves and about splines and what tends to give birth to a spline from a curve. So next is about very few, there actually as of I know there are more than 100 types of splines or curves. So everything can't be covered, and even I don't have that much of wisdom to explain you. But as of now, we can see the important three types called Fremdling spline, BZR curves, and cubic spline. So historically speaking, there have been only two types of lines or any type of things what we know. So one is called the line, second is called scribblings. So scribblings is typically speaking in Tamil Kirkal. So this Kirkal won't have any meaning at all. So is the problem. So only thing what we know exactly in the old days is called the line. So line, as we know, so y equal mx plus c is constant as 0, which is actually spread. So ancient people actually made the diagram using only lines. So even nowadays our calculators or the older games called Mario or some other games have only line elements. So which disadvantage is of lack of details. So modern technology and science has grown enough in the last 200 years, which gives us a need to have a very precise amount of curvatures. So these are the few applications what we are seeing here, the aeroplane or the car, or the human animations, graphics, and second is for architecture. So everything has been grown enough to give the requirements for the curves. So in case we use the curves for ultimate aim of manufacturing. So nowadays the whole manufacturing unit depends only on CAD, so for making CNC programming. So in case if you want to have a CNC program for a curve, we need to define it mathematically. For a line it's become very simple, y equal to mx plus c. For drawing it in a hand, you can use the older French type tool for drawing a plane or a curve, or we can use same arithmetic principle of drawing a spline, spline by hand. But for computer graphics, we need to define it mathematically what the curve is. So usually use curve because to define or to increase the efficiency of any machines, or to make it visually pleasant for in architectural purpose. So in case of aerodynamics, we use it for increasing the efficiency or to reduce the air drag. So these are the few applications. So next and the very most useful application is in computer graphics. Nowadays we use a very advanced graphics systems for playing games. Even though our systems are very fast, so still we need enough space. We don't have enough space to compute it. So this right side example, left side example is for the oldest game versions of line diagram. So in case if we don't know the spline yet, we can't play any three-dimensional games. Only we can see some games like this. And the right side what you see is a combination of curves. So that's a surface, right? So what is the difference between curve and the surface is, for the CAD drawing what we are making here, we use the CAD spline or the line as a vertex. So there is a difference between edge and the vertex. So edge is a combination of vertexes. So in case you take this table, the vertex is the edge line. So usually the vertex is called the straight line or the edge. So edges. So vertex is the combination of two edges. So this is called the vertex number one, vertex number two, if you want to carry this table in CAD. So we use usually spline for using as a vertex or as an edge. So in modern computers or modern programming, we use vertex can be calculated mathematically or easily using computer programming. But for defining an edge, we need a mathematical equation to define it properly in the three-dimensional space. So later in this session, I have wrote a little MATLAB program for telling or explaining about BZR curves. So because of the time constraint, I can't make it as a wide scale of making it for n number of points, but we can see for simple number of points, for 4 or 5 points. So what is the need for making, we have seen the application, right? So what is the need which we got from our applications is most of the engineering applications or the present application usually are needs a seamless connection between the edges or the vertex, which is not possible if you use a straight line, right? Imagine that you can't make this mouse using a straight line. It won't look pleasant also, and you can't able to model it exactly. So, for the next around 1 year, I've been requested. I request you to please be here with me. I don't know how much the present would be or presentation would be. So, whatever you get, I'm confident that at the end of the presentation, I don't know, you may be fully energetic to write a MATLAB program or to explain your students, but I'm quite confident that you can at least go through the book, you'll get some introduction about what is this browser. So the next need where it comes is, if you use a straight line, you will be more constrained. You can't explain a face. You imagine your face, you have to be depicted in a CAD model. It's impossible to do with a line diagram. So the next is, even though our computers are, see my computer is 4i7, which has a 8GB RAM, if I want to run a console simulation or ANSYS simulation or a CAD simulation, sometimes it drags a lot of time. It consumes time because it don't have space to occupy in this RAM space. So that's why we need to reduce the computation load. So imagine if you want to see some animation movie, n number of planes have been rotated in a three-dimensional space. To comfort that, we need enough amount of space. So whatever the space may be, even Google have n number of terabytes of space that is running out now. So like that, we have to reduce our computation load by optimizing the program or using some other equations. So next is suitability for affine transformation. So affine transformation is nothing but that if you want to imagine that if you want to draw a branch with 5 leaves, so there are n number of ways to do it. So the most complicated way is draw the branch, draw one leaf from that. So again you have to make another leaf, that's it. Again make another leaf with it. Like that you have to make 5. So imagine or run it in your brain that five leaves with one branch, you want to develop in a 3D space, how much amount of space will be occupied? But there is the smartest way to do it, that is called affine transformation. Nothing but it's mirroring and projecting it into smaller space. So by using affine transformation, you don't want to reproduce it or you don't want to write it again and again the same program which is overloaded as some computer again. So affine transformation is just mirroring the same object and making it or scaling it. That's all. So next is why. I told you in the starting of the session itself that what we know is line. So later the scribbling has been transformed to spline. Now it's a time for us to know what is line, curve or spline. So line is very simple, right? Y equal to x or y equal to mx plus c equal to 0 is a line. So if you want to change any alteration in it, that is called scribbling. So later we need some mathematical equation to define what is spline. So what people that time know is polynomial. Polynomial is nothing but x square plus x plus 1 or x cube plus x square plus x plus 1 is equal to 0. That's all. But if you use the polynomial to define a curve, that gives you a lot of problems. First is you can't able to get your own structure. If you want to make a C with a little dent in the center, you can't able to make with a simple polynomial spline. So what you have seen in Paint of Microsoft is just a spline, simple spline, polynomial spline, which can be altered later. Also, another problem is you can't use it for affine transformation. If you want to change or scale the polynomial, it will give you a totally a different structure. So obviously that makes a CAD diagram obsolete. So that's why we make first point polynomial after given and normal data points are being given. With the same given data point, if you want to scale the same curve, it will give you a different structure if you see. Next is computationally it's very high. Because the polynomial, we don't have any other program, also we can't be able to parameterize. Parameterizing is nothing but if you whatever data you have to change it to matrix form, that is called parametrizing. So polynomial equation can't be parametrized. So you have to do step by step. We don't have any shortcut method to do it. That's why it consumes lot of memory for the system. Then that's the last one is saying that too high cost of interpolation. So the below diagram tells you that the same polynomial interpolation of a curve, or you take whatever line or scribbling. So the first left side diagram is having a 10 points. The 10 points, you join it with polynomial interpolation, which has been written in MATLAB. If you write a polynomial normalizing or approximation, or you can say it's interpolation. So if you make it for 10 points, the points are like this. But the next curve consists of the same profile, right? Having the same profile of having a speed breaker on the road with 14 points. You see the projection has been totally different. but with the same profile. So if you use what will happen if you use more number, 100 number of polynomial equation to form a same profile, it's impossible. That's why I can show that it's not possible to have affine transformation or reproduce it. So if you save it and make it, if you want to change it to 100 points, the projection will be totally different. If you want to make my case, then if you see, it will become a Yoga space later on. So that we can't do it. So that is why we have to go for some other polynomial equation or some other smarter way to make a curve. So these are the few types as of I know as a curve or the spline. So I forgot to tell you what is line. So line is very simple. I have told you an example. So next is curve. So there is a little controversy about is that line is different, curve is different, or spline is different. So some people tell that all the three are different, but some people tell that line is a special case of curve and curve is a special case of spline. And some people tell that line is a different thing, curve and spline is a combination of it. So as much as I have read, I have got understanding that spline is the original mother of all. So from the spline you can get the curve. From the curve you can get line. But modern programs have proved that from the spline you can directly get the line. So then how to define a line? Line has been defined much and as of now. So next is spline. Spline, we can see curves. Curve is what? You have a circle, right? Conic section, circle. So what is a circle? In the center, you draw with the same distance a circle, it gives ellipse, right? So the curvature is constant. If you take slope at any point of a circle, it gives a constant value that is called curvature. Then what is a segment? A segment is a section of an ellipse or a curve. So then what is plane? Plane is nothing but a curvature or the slope will vary continuously. If a slope of a line varies continuously throughout its infinite length, that is called the spline. If the slope is been varying constantly or the slope is constant, that may be a curve or a line. That's the difference between what? So as much Wikipedia has been defined, they say curves into these many types. There are four major types. First is called algebraic. In that algebraic, we have six different lines. Degree 1, degree 2, degree 3, up to degree 6. So they divided degree 1 as a line, the basic elements. Degree 2 as circle and ellipse. Degree 3 is parabola and hyperbola. Like that it goes up to 6. Basically up to 3, whatever they have defined is called the conic section elements. Circle, ellipse, parabola. You know what is conic element, right? If you have a cone, you cut it straight perpendicular to the base, it is called the ellipse. If you cut it little angle to the base, any degree of angle with respect to the base, that is called ellipse. If you cut it straight parallel to its axis, that is called a parabola. Anything other than the parabola, it gives a hyperbola. So other things are called hyperoid, asteroid, like that, many types. So that second is called transcendental curve. And the third is called piecewise construction curve. So this has find in the modern science, this piecewise construction has given you enough amount of freedom to do it. So whatever we are going to see in the later section of Bezier curves or Hermit curves, this all belongs to the third part called piecewise construction. Why is called piecewise construction to me? It's very difficult to join a parabola with another parabola. And it is impossible to connect another hyperbola with another hyperbola. It will give a totally erratic shape. But if you use piecewise construction of a spline, you can connect n number of spaces with n number of splines. So infinitely you can draw whatever you want in an infinite space, which is not possible with any amount of any curves in algebraic curves. So next is fractal curves. So fractal curves are nothing but a simple line or simple curve, break it however you want. That is called fractal curve or fracture curve. So we see some examples about this. So this is degree 6 asteroid. It's nothing but a circle revolving inside the circle or outside the circle. Whatever you do, it gives the same shape of asteroid. So what's the concept of degree 6 is, if you have any structure revolving over any structure, and the revolving structure, you take one point and follow that point, that gives you a structure that is called the asteroid or transcendental curve, whatever. So one example of this is this. I don't want to bore you much enough, that's why I've taken you only one example regarding this. So this is transcendental curve. Transcendental curve is nothing but you take a revolving circular object and make it roll over any surface, spline surface, flat plate, a rectangular plate, whatever your application may be. So this will give you a curve like this. So this is called a cycloid. If you make a circle to revolve or rotate over a plane without friction, without assuming that there is no friction, that will give you a structure called a cycloid. So application of this, you can find it in many structural elements, architectural elements. So usually we won't see enough about the structure. We see the building and we say, wow, it's very good, but we never get into the details of it. So next time you see any shape, you can follow this out. Actually, many European churches has followed the same cycloid method. So usually there are other example of structures which is called toroid. Toroid is a very famous structure. You take Howrah Bridge or any bridge which has a wire rope to connect it, that formally or naturally forms a structure called a toroid, which means that each point of the element is having a stiffness equal to the gravity. The gravity of each point follows a gravity equal to 9.81 millimeter per second square, that will form a structure called toroid. Or otherwise take a syringe, fill it with water, just push it up, that will form a natural structure of parabola. Actually that is not parabola, that is called a toroid. And the below one is called butterfly curves, which all belongs to transcendentals. This is how it comes is, you take an ellipse, make it to revolve inside the circle and follow any one point of the ellipse, that will give you a butterfly. This all find many applications in mechanical instruments. You can see in tractor also, you can see in older lathe machines, all these applications. And even the cycloid is used in indexing machine. There is one type of indexing machine which uses cycloid profile. So if you want to change the difference for whatever you want to make an indexing, you make a circle design like that, there are special procedures for it, you will get an indexing machine from that. So this is called a fracture curve. This looks very awkward and different to understand, but it's the simplest figure, believe me. So it's very simple, just say starting point, say ending point. That is the starting point. That end is called starting point, and this is the ending point. You make a curve, whatever, polynomial, quadratic, or a simple curve with a circular profile, then make a fracture in the center. So this has formed the center fracture. So this now forms a two curves, right? First one and the second one. Then again in the center form another curve that will give you four curves. So like that you can fracture it any much of time you want, however you want. Anybody can guess what is the application of this or what tends to give the invention of fractal curve. Any idea where you can see? Everybody of our age might have seen this. But we may not have been seen enough details. So if you take any older cartoons, Popeye or Damanche, you can see greeneries or the long back mountains or a very long field of green leaves. You can see this kind of structures. So that was the starting age of making computer animation. So that time they don't have enough amount of programmers to program or the computer to deal with. So that way they make the simplest fractal curve. Make the curve, cut it. You will get some structures, put it behind the screen. You will get a mountain or a tree, whatever you want, color it. So I think famously I have seen in Popeye an amount of this. So next time you see your child, please go through it. So next is our Helmut curve. I think from this on we will get bored enough to watch these slides. I don't get enough amount of pictures also to depict it. So there is no other way we have to go through the equation from this point on. So nothing but this is also a polynomial, but the only thing advantage of this Helmholtz curve is we can able to parameterize it. Parameterizing nothing but we have to make it into a matrix form. If you make it into matrix form, the computer can run 1000 to 1000 or lakh into lakh amount of matrices into a single second or microsecond. But if you want to make it into a polynomial, it takes much amount of time to make it. So in Pro you make some drawing, you want to revolve it. So what happens is there is lakhs of transformation has been done. That means lakhs and lakhs of matrix have been computed internally into the system. So you are visualizing it. It may seem very easy for it, but our system has been very, very complicated, which we could never understand. So this polynomial, this is the first type of piecewise polynomial curves or spline. Equation is nothing but sigma ci into ui. Don't ask me what is ci ui because somebody has been patented it and somebody has listened it. So I can't explain it to explain you mathematically because I'm not a mathematician. So I'm just an engineer. I can tell you where it's applicable, how it's applicable, and its properties, advantages, disadvantages. That's all. So use the parameter ci as a polynomial coefficient. Everybody has solved in 10th the polynomial coefficient. You have to find the constant. So use nothing but the parameter of slope. If you vary the slope, your curve will be very sloping. Because u is very high, it will be very sloping. If u is 0, it will be vertical. That's all. If it is 0, it's impossible. Because in a polynomial equation, if u is 0, it tends to infinity. So line will be infinitely somewhere revolving around the 3D space. So usually it will become 0.01 to 1. whatever. So, these are all the calculations of it. I have written it in a matrix form. So U of P, you see, that is called the parametric equation of whatever we have seen in sigma, right? So this can easily be computed in MATLAB or some other programs. So finally, we are finding what is CO, C1, C2. So one thing I will just tell you what it is. This Hermite cubic curve have one special character, or it has the only character which have only two points. One is start point, another is end point. So another two points is there. To define a Hermite curve, you need four points. One is called start point, one is called end point. The start point, you have another one parameter that is called vector, starting vector. In the end point, you have another one parameter which is called end vector. So I have told you in the beginning itself that we need some freedom to change the curve or to alter the curve, right? So in case if you take this curve, this is a parametric equation to define the whole thing. M is nothing but the matrix. You want to make the matrix from whatever parameter you are using. U is nothing but the start point and end point. Mt is what? The vector or the direction vector. And V is the velocity vector or the constant you can take. So assume this is a curve, Hermite curve, or this, actually this is a Hermite curve. I have drawn some four points using a CAD software. So all these lines I have drawn using paint. So this curve is an actual curve from CAD. So I have made it into red for proper visibility. So there is only two points, right? Start point, end point. You take either of them and start either one of them as end point. So the line shows the vector, where the vector goes. The vector both goes upside, the stiffness of the line will be follow that profile. So the next profile you can see 45 degree inclination, it gives a little change in profile. And if you have 45 degree mirror image of vector, you have a profile of that. If you want to make an actual spline from this Hermite cubic curve, you want to make the vector to face opposite to form a moment. So you can make a spline from Hermite cubic. But the greatest advantage of this process is it's very simple. Even mathematically also you can make it by hand also, you can calculate it. Even for programming also it's very easy. Load for interpolation is little higher than whatever you have seen earlier. And the most and the first disadvantage of this is we don't have enough amount of freedom to alter this curve. Right? We have only start point, end point. If you want to make a fractal curve out of this, it is impossible. You can't write a program. Imagine that you want to make a curve in the center of the curve or the first point, you can't make it. Because it's already been fixed, the polynomial equation will follow the same thing. Or you can say in strength of material way, it will follow the same stiffness. Actually, the need for this curve first comes when they make the shift. If they want to make the shift, they want to make the hull first. Hull will follow a different profile of fish life. So in the early age, they don't have any mathematical or CAD programming to make it. What they do is, they make a very long 10 meters, 15 meters slab, then keep a point in between to make it bending, to make it bend, so that it will follow a hull shape. So mathematically or engineering way, how we can tell is, you are varying the stiffness, right? You are varying the stiffness at each point. So that gives rise to this curve. So disadvantage is less control over the curve. Second is more computation space is needed because it follows a polynomial equation and there is no smarter way to do it. Then the next is very less input. You want to make a curve in paint, the paint still follows the same Hermite cubic curve. Later you can't alter it. Try doing it in Microsoft Paint, you could never change it. But if you go to Photoshop or some other Proe or AutoCAD or modern programming software, they use the curve called BZR curve or B-spline curve, which you can change at any time, any point of the place. So this is about Hermite. Then comes the BZR curve. This is actually a revolution for whatever we say as a CAD revolution or CAM revolution. So how we can say that you can't make a millimicron size of cold roller sheet in cold rolling mill. That is a constraint of manufacturing process, right? I can design whatever I want. I can say that I want a millimicron, 1 millimicron amount thickness of the sheet for making an automobile tank. I can design it. But can it be manufactured? It's literally impossible, maybe in future, but now as of now it is impossible. Like that, the major disadvantage of CAD programming that time is we can't able to change the shape of a curve. That's why what we did is, they discovered not we did, they did. Italian designer or the engineer from Renault Nissan or Nana, later Nissan joined Renault, so actually they called Renault. So they discovered a curve called the BZR curve. The author name is BZR, but this has been before itself, somebody has told the literature, but BZR has actually refined it and give a curve for the Bezier curve. So Bezier curve is nothing but the parametric curve discovered by Panneman based on control points. Actually what you have seen in the earlier Terpitz curve, it's only two control points. Actually that's not a control point, that's a fixed point. But here we can have n number of points, whatever it may be, n number of points with two start and end point which is fixed. Other than that, you can change at any point of time, at any point of the line, you can change the whole length. And the control points is usually 4, but as a polynomial is concerned, we will say n minus 1. If you have 100 points, the polynomial is defined in n minus 1 points. That is called 99. That means x to the power 99 plus x to the power 98, like that it goes up to plus 1 equal to constant. Next, another greatest advantage of this is we can join n number of Bezier curves to n number of Bezier curves. If you want to design a car body, we can make it with a single spline. We need n number of splines. So that can be easily mathematically expressed in CNC way also, and our machines will follow, they can make the profile of it. So nowadays they are making the whole statue of a deity from CNC machining because of the invention of Bezier curve. The Bezier curve was discovered in somewhere around 1800, but it took 1900 to program it. They know what is advantage, but they can't able to program it. The first version of AutoCAD have this Bezier curve in the whole world. They are the first people to have the Bezier curve. So later, parametric transfer calculation, PTC of Pro E has taken this Bezier curve, they modernized it. Because they parameterize this, that way that is what is their job, is parameterizing whatever you are given. So that is called Pro E. Still, Pro E has the best Bezier curve in the world. So nobody could beat it. So another advantage of Bezier curve is the curve's point, whatever defining point you are telling, that never pass through the curve. The Hedwig curves, what you have seen is, we have only 2 points, the curve passed through 2 points. There is no other point. But in Bezier curve, we can have n number of points. Only 2 points will lie inside the curve, that is called start point and the end point. No other point will be inside the curve, that will be usually outside the curve. But what we do is, we interpolate and minimize the distance between both by some algorithm, optimizing algorithm, and we draw the curve for the snowflakes. So this is the equation for Bezier curve. Here we say as a parametric equation or the slope equation u, there we say it as t. Whatever notation you want, you use it. So BIN is the specialist thing here. So in the last year, I written that CN of n, I is equal to some permutation, I have written it, right? That permutation is what which defines the point of the curve. Or the curve, the point which the curve has to follow. So using this equation only, I have written the program. So we'll see in the later. So that is called actually Bernstein polynomial. So I wrote you the formula for Bernstein polynomial also. So I try to explain you that also, but if you see the basic formula, you understand what is BI of N of U. It gives a lot of mathematical derivation and differential equation which I can't use to type in DPD. This is a typical Bezier curve. How many control points? It has 4 control points. So that is another advantage of Bezier curve, which have 4 control points. In that means we have only 2 control points. Literally that is fixed points. You can't change it. If you change it, the whole polynomial will change, the structure will change. But here you have 4 control points. Are with 1 starting point and 1 ending point. But all the 4 are control points. At any point of the time when you are programming or you are designing, you can change all the 4 points to get whatever structure you want. So I have given 4 points V1, V2, V3, V4. But the curve is not in the center of the yellow line. It follows a different path. So it gives us another advantage that if you want to change the structure of a Bezier curve, you have to change the direction vector. So changing the direction vector is very, very difficult task. Even with the highly advanced graphic user interface, we have to change it by hand. Means it's impossible to 1 millimeter on difference. But here, if you want to change the shape, if you drag the point B2 to a longer distance, the graph or the curve will deflect from the original with a very little amount. So you can change in a very precise way. So this is the Kaslitz algorithm. So this algorithm is what I told you, and because of this algorithm only, this curve is following a different path, not going into your control points and it's going to some other space. So it's very easy, D-Amman's algorithm. So this data length is what I have told you, right? Control points are given. This D-Amman algorithm will follow a very simple method of linear interpolation, and D-Amman has given a formula for it. 1 minus T, T is a slope parameter where I have written it as u into 0.0, the coordinate of 0.1 plus slope parameter into whatever I give on the next point p1 or p1, whatever you take. So you will get a value, right, q0. So mark it on there. Next, you follow another linear interpolation. LERP is nothing but the MATLAB version of telling linear interpolation. If you want to linear interpolate some variable by hand, it's very difficult. But in MATLAB, you want to linear interpolation, just like LERP, then give your variable, that will do in a microsecond of linear interpolation. So that's why you copy the program from there directly here. So you can linear interpolate between two lines, you can find a new point, right? Another thing about Bezier curve is it follows as square polynomial. That means x square plus x plus 1 equal to constant. There is another way of telling it, or a different line called cubic span. That follows the cubic root, that's all. Here it's only following the square root, there it's following cubic root. X cube plus x square plus x equal to 1, or plus 1 equal to 1. So what's the difference between both is the slope will be very smooth, or the curve will be very smooth, that's all. If you have a very good system, or if you want a very good computational, or you want a very good CAD diagram, you follow the cubic polynomial. Or if you want a very slopey or adjustable type of clarity, you use Bezier curve. But Bezier curve is some other for all B-splines, plane, whatever. So I have only three lines. So I found a point for each three lines, right? So join these three lines, imaginary. You actually can't able to see this in any CAD software. It's been hidden. So that's why I want to show you like this. So this data line is what I have given, where the curve has to follow, but Bezier curve won't follow. So how it's following a different way is, this is for Bezier curve, so it has only square polynomial, x square plus x plus 1 equal to constant. So these are the three points by linear interpolation. You can change the linear interpolation at any time, as of you want. You can refer to a programmer, write whatever you want. So imaginarily join the lines, three points into a line, so we get another line, right? Then step two, again linear interpolate these two lines. You will get another two points. Just connect that line, connect that point to the line, R0, R1 as the end point and start point. So now what we have to do is find one point in the last line. So whatever you are seeing is very simple programming with parametric equation. So this, whatever, will take much time to understand, but system will do in msec. So finally we got only one point. Now you can see only three points, right? One is start point, one is end point, another one is the interpolated point. Now you join these three points with any curve. Or you join the start point into the interpolation point with one circular curve, and then with that interpolation point with this end point to one circular curve. Or you use the polynomial equation to join these three points. That will give you a curve called Bezier curve. So this is actually a MATLAB programming for whatever DLMS program. So I made the program, then I take only the graph here to explain. So since my ability to program is limited, I can't able to go up to infinity. So I have taken up to 3.5 up to 10. I assume it is using Paint or Photoshop. So I have given 3 points, right? P0, P1, P2. Then I am linear interpreting it. Another new point using the formula what the DLMS has given. Next, I found a final point on that line, which is called the interpolation point or the final interpolation point. Then I use the curve to join it. That's all. This is Bezier curve. So it looks very complicated, but if you go through any book, the best book I have seen is Ibrahim Zaid, Mastering CAD, which explains very well. And also there are many other books like Tata Nagar and another book which I forget it, that gives you very much clarity about what our curves are. So this is another example of Bezier curve. So I have given you dots, right? Connecting points. So this can have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. So this is actually a connecting or control point for Bezier curve. So the start point is P0, end point is P1. The lines are called links or line elements, whatever you want you can define it. So how the Bezier curve will follow is, this is a Bezier curve. So whatever interpolation I have told you is happening between all the three links in between. You take any three links connected, that will form a Bezier curve. I think I went very fast. So what are the advantages of Bezier curve is, it's giving you more control over the curve. So whenever you want to change it, you can drag that point up and down or in z direction 3-dimensional space, you will get a new structure which will affect all the curves, not only the points, it will affect all the curves. Remember that. So another advantage of this Bezier curves, it's very smooth, continuous. If you want a very very smooth curve, go for higher polynomial. X equals 10 also you can use it. What I have shown you is x to the power 2. So next what we see is x to the power 3. So it's a very smooth and continuous curve. So start point, end point will be in curve. No other point will be inside the curve, or it will not be followed by the spline what you are drawing. Convex hull property, that is a different property. So convex hull property means you can draw an imaginary polygon or square, whatever structure you want, using all this point, right? So you take the edgemost or the endmost point. So in this drawing you can see the end point as P1, P0, P3. This is the end point. You draw a polygon with this. So you can find that at any point of time, the curve will never go out of this polygon. Either two-dimensional space or the three-dimensional space, it will never go out. Because if you make a very complicated animation, that time you use some curve which will go out of this space, that means that surface is going to crash some other subject, so which will give you a wrong result. So assume that we are doing in ANSYS. So I don't know whether this curve or whatever curve I'm drawing is following a common cell property they have or not. So I make some property, I assemble a bolt or not. The thread can go inside the bolt thread, right? So that time, then after that PROE, I will import to the ANSYS. There if you mesh it, the ANSYS machine or the algorithm don't know how to mesh the interface to surface. They don't know whether it is welded or they are joined, or simply technically speaking, this you have a same material, right? The space in between the interaction, the machine will assume that the density is doubled, right? In the same unit, square meter or square meter cube, if you interface two surface, that means there is a point where, or this area or the volume where, there are more density in the material. So obviously whatever result you are going to get will be wrong. So as an engineer or a technical person or a teacher, we should be aware of what it is or where we can make the mistake. So that is the motto of my presentation. I am not here to explain that whole mathematical equation. I just want to tell you what is the advantage, disadvantage, or where we can probably make mistakes. So that is about common cell property. And another very important thing is, usually before Bezier spline has been discovered, there were two separate programmings for lines and splines. Because your Hermit curves or any other curve will never going to follow a straight line, because that is polynomial. But Bezier curve, after Bezier curve comes, if you keep any three lines together, or if your control points lie in a same line, collinear, that will form a straight line. So there is no need for a straight line program, right? We are eliminating another one hectic program for making a line. So with the same Bezier curve program, you can make a straight line. So that is a very good advantage of another Bezier line. So that's what I told. Assume that P0, P1, P2, P3 are in the same line. It will give a straight line, right? So that is another advantage of it. So next is cubic Bezier curve. This is nothing but, there we have stopped up to that red line, because we interpolated twice. Here we need more smoothness, that's why we interpolate another one time. We got another yellow line to interpolate. Nothing but interpret LERP what I have given you the equation, do it one more time. So you get another one line and join the interpolation point starting end point. So you get a very very smooth line. So this has cubic curve, which has n cubic, Bezier cubic curves has been used in designing of aerofoil design. So nowadays for any jet propulsion, we need a very accurate programming and very accurate schedule for increasing efficiency, whatever efficiency, thermal or projection, propulsion efficiency. We need a very smooth surface. For creating that smooth surface, we can't do it in hand. So we have to go for CNC programming. If we want to go for CNC programming, we need obviously a mathematical equation to define the path. Here path is nothing but the spline of the curve. So here they use it. So as of now, I think time is not much enough. I have hour more remaining. So if there is any doubt, you can ask at any time. I don't know. Next is like, because time has been more, I just want to give something important about some other programming languages. So this is a MATLAB environment. I don't know how many, do anybody use it? If initially if you follow C program or Fortran programming, it becomes very hectic to define what is the variable. You want to tell any variable in C, we have to tell it is scalar or vector or it's a numerical or it's a decimal point or whatever. So here this specially is meant for engineers that we don't want to say what is the input is. We just can give an input and they will assume whatever input it is. So here you can see a basic MATLAB version of my computer. So this is a program environment. Here you can type whatever program you want for testing purpose only, not for full time programming. And this is I have set it like whatever program I have already. You can change it the environment at any time you want. So next is workspace. Workspace is nothing but where you can save all your variables. So you say A is a variable which has 2 as a value, that will be displayed there, that's all. And this is command history. You don't want to type the history again and again and again and again. So you can use it very easily whatever you have written on the want to write any program in MATLAB. So first you can't write it just like that in C program. In C you have to write and save. Here you have to save and write, that's all. So first you have to go to, in C we use it as executable files. Here we say it's document files, that's all. So there are many advantages of this MATLAB. It also contains very sharp and easily doing commands. One of the greatest advantages of MATLAB is they have already a pre-made programming. If you want to do a transpose in MATLAB, it's very easy. A, you have to say some matrix. Then transposing it in real time is very difficult. In C, it's literally impossible for a mechanical engineer to program a code in C. So MATLAB will do in a simple code, A to the power transpose to do this. So write a M file, you have to click this new script or file, go to new. So here you can write whatever program you have. So let me open my program what I have written. So before that, another thing about MATLAB is you can write program whatever you want, but you have to save it in the same directory where you have proposed to MATLAB. So here I have n number of programs anywhere, everywhere stored in system. But here I have saved in my own directory called CD. So CD is a command for changing the directory, change of directory CD. So if you press the upper button, you can see the command I have already used. This is a command for changing the directory. So the directory has now been changed to my own directory. So now you can open our program. I have tried some 3-4 programs which give no results. So finally I thought because of time, I can't write an elaborate program. So for as of now, I wrote a very simple program for bezier with n number of points. So I just use the interpolation point, right? Cij, I told you that it's a permutation of whatever input you have and the control points have. So this program I have written it for n number of points. Either you can give your input points or you can select it from the graph. So this clear all and CLC tells that CLC is nothing but clear all. Clear your screen, that's all. CLC will clear everything. Sorry, CLC will clear your screen, clear all of you, delete all the variables. So we can see basics of MATLAB. I will tell you that A is some variable, which is the value of 2. Enter, you can have 2, which is being replicated from MATLAB. And you can see here that in workspace, the A has been given. So that tells that already a variable A has been saved in your system, don't do it again. Now again if I tell that A is equal to 4, that will be overwritten and make it into 4. So MATLAB is not variable constant. So that will change the variable at any time. But in C program if you tell that A is 2, that will be there until the program dies or you die, the A will be 2. So this is a thing to make advantage also and a thing to be cautious also. So you may do many mistakes. So I can tell you very simply A is equal to 4. Again it gives the output of A equal to 4, A equal to 4. In case at some point of time you don't want the system to be replicate whatever you are doing, it's very simple that put a semicolon at the end of any command that will never interpolate it, that will never give you back. So now I want to clean the screen, right? So it's become very hectic for me to understand. Put CLC. the screen has been clean, but the variable is there already. If you want to remove the variable also, type clear up, press enter, that will remove the whole variable stored in the system. So next is very simple program. We can see A is equal to 3, B is equal to 5, C is equal to A plus B, input C equal to A. So it's like a very easy thing, right? Like a calculator, you may think that why I have to type it here, calculator will do it. But if you want to go for higher program like BGR Gauss, I think for me MATLAB is the only way to do it because I'm not putting any other programming. So this is a program for simplest BGR Gauss, not exact BGR Gauss. This follows only basic version, that is called Bernstein equation, what I have shown you, the sigma of pi into whatever slope factor you have. So n is my input. I'm telling the system to clear the first. So this clear all is telling that clear the system and clear all the variables, because there may be some other variable already stored by the user with the same name what I have been using it now. So next I'm telling that n is equal to input space gap. I have written enter number of times. That means the system will take the input from the user. Next, I have written a if program. W is my variable. I think you can get it from me, this program, or I can send you mail of this program, better than understood. So one thing I want to tell you is this sigma I plus 1 factorial of n. So if you want to do a factorial on your own by hand, it takes hours. I think now you might have forgot all the schoolings, whatever done. So this simple factorial command will do whatever factorial you have. This is a command for doing factorial things. So this is a Bernstein equation or the interpolation equation what I have shown you, sir. So then I have drawn a line and I have plotted the circle. CLT is nothing but concatenation. So now I have run this program, right? So we have to press play. In your command window that will ask you how many points you want. So whatever we give, three control points, give enter. So it's asking me that either you want to use mouse or you want to use give input. So for us, we can accept if you can't able to specifically give 0.001, 0.002 space. So let me go for keep a mouse. So press 1 and enter. So this is a space. So here you can see the axis is 100 to 100 because I have already told the system that axis is between 0 to 0, 0 to 100 and 0 to 100. This 0 to 100 is for x axis and 0 to 100 is for y axis. If I make this very big, my computation will become very difficult. My system will run it, no problem, but unnecessary space. Now I have to just click 3 points, that's all. So this may be my first point, this may be my second point, this may be my third point. So this is a BGR Gauss, that done interpolation of, simplest interpolation of what is called the C factorial, and you got the curve. So this is the 3 points on the line, and this is called the BGR Gauss what we have seen. We can go again also, no problem. We can give a number of points. How many points? We can give 6 points. Give up. 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So now you can see the Kahn's help property or Kahn's curve property also. So this curve never went out of our box. It's always been inside the box. So this is another advantage of BGR and a disadvantage of BGR. So is there any other doubt regarding this? Or anything regarding that or them, as much as I know I can tell you. So who are interested can give you or my idea, I'll send you this one program and you can learn it on. And another advantage of MATLAB is having a lot of toolboxes. So toolbox means, I don't know how we could understand. So whatever you do, neural networks or fuzzy logic or anything, you can do this very easily. So whatever you want to do, go for neural network toolbox or fuzzy logic toolbox, or n number of toolboxes are there. Whoever want to do anything, use this. And if you want to specify a matrix in MATLAB, if I want to specify a matrix, you have to write like this. So this is a row, semicolon that goes to another row, semicolon that goes to another row. So this gives you a
On behalf of the gathering, I would like to thank Mr. Ram Kumar for his valuable session and hope the session will be useful and fruitful for the people who are available here. And we also got exposure on the MATLAB how to use it, which most of us may not be aware of or not used for it. And also personally thank him for the session, valuable session. And we'll have a break for 15 minutes and after that we'll gather here, after that Mr. Muthukumar will take over the session. Thank you.
We have seen about the representation of curves. So this is going to be continuity of this representations again, but in the other sense, like how the surfaces are going to be represented. What are the various curves we have seen in the morning? Just recollect that. Maybe it is polynomial curve, or by cubic, or Hermite, or this line, whatever it may be. If they can be generated in the form of surfaces, we have seen something like free-form surfaces. Why I put this as a first slide is because for freestyle modeling of cars or any artistic objects, nowadays people use extensively this CAD. Earlier there were artists who do it with their own experience or their own expertise. What we see as a general form of this polynomial curves is available in the form of two templates in the name of French curves or curves. But being engineers, we should technically understand how these curves are manipulated in the form of models. All the shapes are not straight, they are not planar. Some of the shapes are getting curved, and the degree of curve is varying. Now this slide is just to understand what is the order of these curves. First we start with zero. That means you have some constancy with respect to positions. Now what we feel as constancy is only about these control points. What is being varied? What we can manipulate in order to get changes in the shapes. So the zero order continuity is represented by the letter C with the superfix as zero. So this will come under notations in later in this slides. So I will prefer to put it in the first hand. Then first order continuity represented by C, superfix by 1. This for this slope, we know that y is equal to m6 squared. It's an equation of the slope can be represented by constant c or variables like x or y. We have second degree, first degree, or the other order polynomials. Irrespective of the functions we are dealing with, we are going to term it with some notations. So m is going to be some slope. So if you want to know the constant with respect to slope, it will come under first order. So what is the probable item or element you want to choose is an line element. So what you will get apart from the zero, after the zeroth element, zeroth order, is the first order as the line element. So which will not consider to be a curve. Okay, but basically when we see some set of elements as curve, it starts with point and it's it is denoted as a second one. What is very usual for us to denote for edges or any boundary is lines, straight lines. Now second order continuity is the point of discussion now, that is coming under curvature. So whenever you see some the denotations in equations, it is most probably related to the last category called second order continuity. Now this curvature is going to have some number of control points. When we see the zeroth order continuity, it is only limited to a point, only locations. The location may be changed. There is no other associated things. It is an individual point. Okay, but we call as node in finite element analysis. But when it comes to set of this nodes or points, it may be line element. Now when we have more than two, it can define a curvature. So that's why we have in the third order continuity the name called the curves. So this curve can be a regular curve as we see it, like circle, ellipse, or and part of a circle like arc, elliptical arc, anything like that. How many of you have seen usage of this curves like Hermite curve, cubic curve in the day-to-day use? They are not directly used, but when we manipulate with the shapes, automatically these other kind of curves are coming into picture. Of course, for the 10 years of CAD experience, I have never used the selection of this cubic or bicubic from the toolboxes or icons, but as I am working on the models, inevitably I see some other shapes like which is not falling under arc or elliptical curve, which will be necessarily be defined under some other category. So the last session was a very beautiful session to give an introduction like what is going to be the different kinds of curves. So we are dealing with something called the third order continuity, which is under the curvatures. I will go back to the first slide. The topic of discussion now is going to be BCF curve. Even though that two other topics we are going to cover today, we'll start with BCF because we have been introduced with this year course in the last sessions. What are the special things about DCS? That ease of control, programming part, and understanding the curves for easier animations or anything like that. So it was first of the time to be developed, first of the time to be exploited, and more standardized than other curves, more used than the Hermite or other kind of curves. We can say that the other curves are just the subdivision of this DCS curves. Even in computer screen, when we leave the screen unattended for some time, we have some playing of the videos as a screen server. The famous screen server, an animator or anybody who is enthusiastic with curves will put his DCS curve on the screen. Somebody who is imagining about more about models, they will put some cubes, the formation of them. Right? When we see about this curves forming on the screen, we can see how this continuity is there for each generation of the loop of the curves, how this the curves are repeating, overlapping, how it is fascinating to see these curves. Our job is to use this kind of curves for creation of models. So like I said, the first creation of models, that is for preform modeling of car body or any household appliances or anything which is applicable to the preform shapes. Most importantly is why we want to make your car body so much curvature? Any idea? Why it cannot be straight like the old type of bus? Why we need that much of curve for the moving body?
Aerodynamic.
And when we simulate with the CFD software, we can get the best results with this kind of curves. So aerodynamic shapes are able to be get by just modifying these control points. Now our job is to change some of the control points, and computer takes over to make sure that this continuity or propagation of curves is as per the polynomial curves. We only need to give the degree of the curve, the nature of the curve, and the formation of the curve is taken care by computer. So that is the computer-assisted shape formation nowadays. And if you talk about softwares, the oldest softwares like Dassault Systems, CATIA, or the IDEAS, they have been very much specialized in using this kind of surface modeling, preform surface modeling, or sculpturing, or so on. So, first of all, we need to understand what are the basic polynomials then we want to see how much of shapes changes are there from curve to curve, and then we can distinguish between these curves. Right? So, of course, we want to manipulate the curves, what we have seen in the last session, and develop some idea on the curves using parametric equation. Why we want to give importance to the parametric equations is basically, as we said, circle's equation in x and y is restricted in its radius, like x square plus y square equal to r square. There are going to be some basic equations when we talk about parabola, y square equal to 4ac or something like that. We want to see it as a mathematical equation so that this parameters can be changed either by manual calculation or by calculation with the help of the computers. And we have seen the earlier classes like how computers are helpful for matrix manipulation or even derivative or integrative uses of the equations. Now this Bezier curve is an extension of Bezier curve. It has got two directions. It can be assumed like x and y direction. But those who are familiar with the time-term analysis are basically like fluid mechanics. They would have known something like u and v. Right? This u and v are here only representing some directions, not the velocities. Now, an ordinary set of data or control points used to build a topologically rectangular surface. When we take the shape of a base, flower base, or a cylinder, or something like a glass, wine glass, something like that, in order to represent it on the screen, for generating the images of the screen, we need to create a rectangular set of points, which is very easier to obtain by refreshing the pixels on the screen. So this becomes an easier method. Why AutoCAD or parametric corporations like this ProEngineer, they have utilized these curves for most of the uses for the enhancing the product capability, is its flexibility and easiness to generate the points and to show the images of three-dimensional objects easily on the screen. So the number of control points required to manipulate is less. So it is working with a rectangular surface, we will see that. So we require two set of things. One is n plus 1 and another one is m plus 1. And these are the separate set of control points. So this is associated with u and v directions. And if you take something like n plus 1 and m plus 1.
Here.
N plus 1 is associated with 3 plus 1. And m plus 1 is associated with 4 plus 1 in the corresponding directions of u and v. And what we have as u and v is given at the bottom of the screen here.
We have here a point called v not not and two directions. U is the vertical direction and v is the horizontal direction. We want to plot some points and obtain a surface.
So there may be number of points like P00, P10, P21, up to PNM. So it is like a matrix form now. The number of points is defined by N and M. Why it is given N plus 1, M plus 1 is because basically we have a common point called P00, the origin point. The BCS surface is defined with the polynomial of degree, which is given by the polynomial V with respect to U and V. In the directions of U and V, any point on the surface can be represented with this equation, polynomial equation. It's a general polynomial equation. It's a simpler form of the polynomial equation, giving limitations to U and V between 0 and 1. And this is forming equation number 1 for us. And what is the polynomial function popularly called is Bernstein form equation, because it is basic for BCR curve as well as BCR surface. BCR surface is just developed from BCR curve. Now, we go back to this again. See how many rectangular surfaces are being plotted out here. We first, with respect to this first point, the 4 corresponds to n plus 1 and 5 corresponds to m plus 1. And we have the control points defining rectangular spaces over there. And what we have actually generation of the curve is bound by this rectangular control set of control points. So it is easier to manipulate. In the earlier in the session also we have seen the actual formation of the curve is different from the locations of the control points. So it is a polynomial's job is to take the curvature towards the directions, right? And this Bernstein polynomial coefficient will have some equations. This is a polynomial coefficient equations to know about the C, which is coming in the equations. So the capital C is the coefficient. Just like any other coefficient we have in equations, the coefficient is bound by some formula. The boundary values of the polynomial coefficients in both directions is calculated with some respect to some equations. So just like any finite element methods, which is formulated from the theoretical background of mathematics, the understanding of the polynomials should also have coefficients, its boundary values, the limitations, and then only we can possibly apply and know about its extensions. Right. These are the coefficients. And the equations are given with respect to I and J. Here I factorial is 0 and N. Then the coefficient values are 1 in one U direction, that is the first direction. When J, the other factor, is 0 and M for the other direction, the coefficient values are 1 in the V direction, because the limitation for U and V is only between 0 and 1. So in between you can have n number of values, taken the degree of polynomial is as per the number of decimals we impose on the. So between 0 and 1, how many values you can impose, how many values you can think of. So in fractions it can be in lakhs also. So that many control points can be employed. So when expanding the equation number 1, what we have seen in the earlier slide, this equation number 1, which is between two parameters u and v, both for 0 and 1, we have symmetric terms and as well as non-symmetric terms. So we can get some symmetric terms, and the symmetric terms are like I equal to 0, I mean j of 0, 0, 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, where these are becoming just like similar terms or pair terms. When I and j become 1 and I and j become 2, we have differences of this equation. This equation is going to be getting its different forms when you apply for different values of I and j. So when you suffix with 0, 0 or 1, 1, 2, 2, the appropriate terms in the equation get expanded. And for unsymmetric terms, that is non-symmetric terms, when I is 1 and j is 0, the equation form differs. This is going to give you an idea about how the curvature is going to change, whether it is affected for any control points or not. And lastly, when I is equal to n and j equal to 0, then the equation takes a very simple form, which is which can be written for the specific case. I equal to 0 and j equal to m. And again, when we expand with respect to the all set of points, the full polynomial equation may look like this. The polynomial of p in terms of u and v may be looking like this, but it depends upon how many control points of n and m you are using in the directions of u and v. And as we have seen in the last session, this is entirely depending upon number of points we want to use, and the number of points is divided between the two directions, and the degree of curve is automatically getting associated with this. Now we have symmetric term as 1, 1, 2, 2, and the non-symmetric terms have just as 1. It may look a little bit confusing, but whatever equations we have seen in the first slides, the earlier slides, is going to be put together and given as a final form. So we need not bother about how these equations are being formed, we need not derive any equations, but it is only as per this polynomial equation which curve is going to follow some directions. So basically having some set of symmetric terms and non-symmetric terms. That's why we have dealt with two set of terms separately. Whether it is the suffix same or suffix different, that is going to be symmetric and non-symmetric basically. And then when it comes to simpler definition, what we have put as the first equation, this is enough to describe a BCF surface in the two directions. is two directions of U and V alone, which is having its limitations of changes of the parameters U and V between 0 and 1. For a cubic BZF surface, which is in classifications under BZF, the basic BZF surface, we have the limitations of N and M only up to 3. Now, we have the reason for why it is called cubic. Something is called cubic means its degree is 3. Now, the changes in the parameter can be affected between I is equal to 0, 1, 2 and 3. Similarly, J can be 1, 2 and 3. So, it is a simplified form of the general BZF curve, we can say, or a more usual form of BZF surface. Again, the directional properties are not changed. U is between 0 and 1 and V is between 0 and 1 only. It is a special case of BZF surface, we can say. And again, like we expand the general BZF equation, we'll have a symmetric terms and non-symmetric terms. The equations may look bigger, but it's a set of these terms only. Now, you want to impose a matrix form for this because it is not so easy to understand with respect to this equation, polynomial form. We will reduce it into the form of matrix, because what we are going to give to the computer's hand is only this matrix manipulations, not the polynomial. It is not going to solve directly this polynomial and arrive at some curve. So the same set of equation what we have seen in the previous slide, this all changes can be simply put in the form of matrix. So this is to represent, easy to know about individual parameter changes, and the locations of these points is defined by this bigger 4+4 matrix here. So these are the control points we are going to work. Now, how much is N and how much is M? We have 4+4 here, and any idea about the values of N and M for general BCF? Now we will go back to this previous slide. Now, this N+1, M+1 is going to define this final equation. And what we have as N and M is nothing but this equation here, the order of this equation, N cross M. Right? Now, that many number of control points you are going to play with. Okay, control points. These are the control points. Now, these control points in the actual surface are scattered over the surface, and with the proper degree given to it, they have their own positions. This control points can be arranged. The curve will automatically associate with respect to the control points. It is up to the designer to choose each individual control point and adjust to our requirements. In the case of CFD or any other finite analysis of flow, the best suitable solutions are arrived at. That this can be these limitations. Between these values, your parameters should change. And accordingly, we can give instruction to the computer to adjust these values. So this locations of the points can be decided and best surface can be arrived. And for the other form, we have the directions U and V alone. Now this is with respect to these coefficients and points for Bernstein equation, the first equation. And with respect to these directions, we have the second form. Like we have discussed in the last class, this Cartesian and space representations are also important. Now we are not discussing anything about the fundamental directions like x, y, z. Now we will associate with the directions now in order to properly place, whether it is placed horizontally, vertically, or angular to any of these surfaces. primary plane surfaces that we need to understand only with respect to this known world coordinates or values. Now, if you associate four points P00, P30, P33, and P03 in four corner points of a rectangle, then the value of U and P can be only one. So, in parametric space, yeah, this year surface will look like this only with only four control points. The number of control points has to be increased further in order to give a look of the actual curve. So this is the basic number of points required. Now, when we manipulate with more such control points, the locations of the points, control points in each one of the rectangular grid will lead to a complete surface, because the number of points can be increased as per the order of U, N and M. So you can have a basic parametric space in the parameters U and V like this only, but in Cartesian space it can take as many number of points, that is in x, y, z directions, it may take as many number of points as required or as defined earlier, so it may take a suitable shape. And again, this set of points for whatever we have discussed in the previous slide can be represented as the sum of vectors, the points in x, y and z direction. What we call as Cartesian is set of these three x, y, z directions. When we put it in matrix form, we can see these control points are properly defined in this Cartesian form. So now we can manipulate with this value. There are four control points in U direction, four control points in V direction, and the set of control points will give rise to an equation form for BCS surface for any value of U and B. So between 1 and 0 you can take any value. For a uniform value of 0.5 you get an equation like this, and the values of the coordinates for each control point is represented by the values here. For the first control point, it is actually located to the minus direction of the x, and it is at the origin of y direction, and in three positions from the z direction. So we can imagine about the location of the point given the three Cartesian directions. Where is the first point? It is the negative direction, it is on the negative direction of the x. It is not in the height position, it is new, it is on the same reference line, but in the z direction it has moved to some position. So any point has to be represented by three values in Cartesian, and any set of number of control points can be defined to completely define this BCS surface. So that's the beauty of it. We have a set of these points in Cartesian representation. This can be brought down to an equation polynomial form also. But this is an easier form of understanding, as we are very much used to coordinate entry in systems. So when we have decided some number of points for generating a curve, we can first of all write these points according to the values of U and V as a constant value of like 0.5 here, or you may assume 0, or you may assume the maximum value of 1. But it is up to the designer to choose the points. And the computer may list down some number of nodes. When you have designed, you have made some surface like this, the computer may list down. It is not always the job of the designer to locate the point. First hand, you can define a trial surface, and later on you can try with these values of U and V, change it, and when you are satisfied with the degree of curve according to the requirement, like it is computationally fluid dynamic or a streamlined surface or whatever it is, you can optimize the surface by simply adjusting the values of U and V. You can play with these values of U and V in order to get different control points. That's the beauty of BCS surface. You need not have control over each and every control point. You need to have control over the two parameters of two directions like U and V. And if you change independently these values, or together these values, the degree of curve is automatically adjusted. Now, when we have 3 plus 1, that is n plus 1 and 3 plus 1 for m plus 1, the resultant surface will be cubic surface. All that, as we know, n and m, then they are equal to 3. We get a characteristic cubic surface. When we purposefully need it as a cubic surface, we can make it to be 3 plus 1 and 3 plus 1 for 4 set of control points, u and v directions. So what we have is the 4 plus 4 matrix is actually a cubic Bezier surface obtainable in parametric space. It is easier to represent, easier to know about the various control points locations rather than their polynomial form. So first of all, we will define a trial surface also. We will just try with plotting these points on this screen. So whether these control points are good or bad, it's up to the designer to choose to be correct or not. And everything is coming under some requirement. So where you are going to apply, depending upon that, we can choose this values. The same form for third order, that is a cubic Bezier surface. The equations are generally written in this form. This we have seen already in the name of cubic Bezier surface equation. Right. It has a general form here, the equation again. For an example, as we have taken for U and V as 0.5, the location of the control point can be given in the final form as a polynomial term here. As the first set of equations, a vector of control coefficients, and another one, a line vector in order to change the parameter values. Now see that this set of parameters are between only 0 and 1. And the actual points may be any value. This Cartesian values may be any value. But the control values are in the directions U and V. They are between 0 and 1. So we can identify any flaws in the equations also by looking in the matrix form. So for U and V taken as 0.5 and 0.5, you have a final solutions of these equations as a location of a point which is defined as per the Cartesian formula like this. You want to know about a location of a point, then you can do the matrix manipulation. We need not do it manually. It can be given to the computer to solve out for the location of a point, to indicate the location of a point. And finally, the characteristics of Bezier surfaces. As we have seen from this picture, any curved boundary is encapsulated in some rectangular set of control points, and the actual formation of the curves is as per the polynomial equation. It is becoming very simpler to represent the screen. First, the basic form can be conceptualized, and the other kind of views like realistic views or anything can be given in the screen with the application of this Bezier curves. So they are using it in the screen refreshing also, in the computer graphics, this representation of the surfaces. In AutoCAD, if you see the older versions, they don't represent the actual curved surfaces to be curved. Whenever you look at a segment of a circle, zoom down to the focus levels, you'll see like it is bounded by some small number of straight lines only. It is for the representation purpose, because the graphics will consume more memory when it is representing curved entities, because the number of points to represent a curved boundary is more. Now, this is also used for representation on the screen. Now, the first point is that this surface will interpolate only 4 corner control points. You don't need to play any more number of values. This is the least value or the most value for changing the curvature of the surface. The surface is tangent to the corner segments of the control polyhedron. What we have is polyhedron here is enclosing of this rectangular feather control points to form a volume. This polyhedron may grow or diminish based upon the locations of the control points. It has got a convex hull property. What we see as the topological property with respect to volume, it is generally referred to as convex hull. The shape of the PCA surface can be modified by changing some of the vertices, what we call as control points of the polyhedron. That means individually this set of surfaces defined basically by this four control points, or by keeping the polyhedron fixed and specifying number of coincident points on the same vertices. So how we can define this? The polyhedron, one of the polyhedron may be fixed, that is your four rectangular control points may be fixed, the other may be varying. Depending upon that, your final shape may change. A closed PCA surface can be generated by closing its polyhedron or choosing coincident corner points. This coincident corner points is like fixing some of the control points. If they fix four set of control points, you get to change the other set of the rectangular corner points. Okay. Two more. Your PCA surface has global control. That means when you change an individual control point, all other points get changed inevitably, because the polynomial is defined by the directions U and V, and change of location of one will certainly affect the other point other than the first and last point. The number of the degree of surface is tied to the number of control points. That means whether you select n plus 1 as 3 or 4 or m plus 1 to be 3 or 4, the degree of the surface, what we usually name it as curvature, is only dependent on the number. It's easier to understand, easier to manipulate, not so difficult, easier to use it in the computer graphics. Which has been much extensively used in the softwares for its simplicity, and that becomes an advantage here. It does not require tangent respect us. Now, so far we have not seen anything like normal tangent or associated angles, something like that. It's very simple. It's four set of control points and location of the Cartesian points, and adjustment of the whole surface based upon locations of the Cartesian coordinate points. And the only limitation is the local control. That suppose I want a small dent in the surface, you cannot achieve it. Suppose I want to see for a whole feature on a planar surface, it cannot be achieved. When you look at the final surface, it will look awkward. We will not get what we expect. So it is more applicable to surfaces which have no internal features or no sudden changes in the directions. And the object is like a flower vase or something like a ball which is very uniform in its shape. This PCA surface is very much applicable. When the shape of the object becomes very complex, we'll have to avoid this PCA surface and stick on to some other surfaces. Taken as a starting curve, we can start with PCA curves, and as a special case, we can always use cubic PCA surfaces, and then we can try it and impose some other set of curves. Right. With this, I conclude this part of PCA surfaces. If you have got any doubts or any clarifications, you can make it now. Shall I go on for the bicubic surfaces and surface patches? Okay. Surfaces are again an extension of this baseline curves. You want to see how this baseline curves are there. Where will be the baseline curve? Baseline curve. This is going to be again the repetition of the same equation, polynomial and all. But the difference is there in the basic polynomial equation. See here, the set of points is defined by the, again, the two factors U and V, but the changes in the values can be from the same parameter itself. That is, up to U you can take the variations, up to V you can take the variation. It is not limited to one, as in the case of these here surfaces. So you can have n plus 1 control points, and the variation is further or increased than the BCF curve. Okay? So you can impose some local variations in the surfaces. That is the future here. If you want to see as an advancement of this, as a special case of this baseline curves, how it is superior to the earlier BCF curve, you can have local controls. You can just add up some control points, individually attack the point, control point, so your final curve will be as per your requirement. As we have seen in the last P, U of P is P of the equation is the polynomial again. Any point on the surface, it is any point, and the P I comma j is the number of control points. How many number of control points we are going to get now? It is dependent on the value of n and n. Now, the function here given is a basis function. First n function is a basis function in u direction, and the n function again given in the v direction. Now it is only a summation of these two functions for a point on the surface in order to completely define the overall surface here as a function of u and v. Right. And v is the maximum of value more than 1 also. Now the baseline surface equation can be rewritten again using this matrix form. Under this product method, which is defining first for the first basis like u in terms of u as a line vector, and the set of control points is defined by the 4 cross 4 or 5 cross 5, how many number of sets you are having as per the value of the n and m, and again defined by this line vector in the v directions. The basis function, like you see in the coefficient in the case of BCR, this is called basis function here, because its representation of representation is not in the factorial form now. Now it takes a different form, but the limitation is u can be any value, not necessarily 0 and 1, can be any value for both u and v directions. Now, as per the value of k in the polynomial equation, you have surface of degree k minus 1 in one direction, and the value of l in the polynomial equation produces a different degree in the v direction. That is giving you local control in the surface, rather than the case of BCF surface, which is global control. We have one directional control, that is u direction control and v direction control, which is very much useful for the person who is working to change the properties in the desired direction, whether it is in the x direction or y direction, as we say usually. So individual control can be established in individual directions. The values of the u and v may be changing in decreasing integer value, like it can be minus 1, minus 2, something like that. This is called k naught values, and subsequently it will form a vector called k naught vector. And the properties of this vectors, u vector and v vector, as a line vectors, they are very much similar to the baseline curves. The major advantage, as you have seen, is the local control. You want to specifically attack to the direction. As a designer, it gives more job, laborious work to have the final shape. Whereas in the case of a bezier surface, the designer's work is to simply adjust the value of U and V, or adjust only one of the control points in order to get changes in the overall surface. Here, you can get the changes in the surface, final surface according to the direction changes you are giving in U direction or V direction. If the k value is equal to n plus 1, that, like we have seen in the last case, like for bezier surfaces, what happens when the value of u becomes, I becomes 0 and I becomes 1. So, and so, if it is becoming the value, total value, the total number of control points used in u direction and the value of l is equal to m1, m plus 1. That means the number of total control points used in V direction means the resultant surface will become bezier nature. So we can reduce the baseline surface into a bezier surface with the approximation of this one. When we put the value of k, which is the constant value here, to simply n plus 1, and similarly when we put the value of L equal to m plus 1, which is very similar to the representation of bezier surface, so you can simplify baseline surface to a bezier surface. And in this case, U becomes limited to 0, and the maximum value may be from n minus k plus 1, and for V, similarly it is 0 to V minus L plus 1. Then L and K values are to be limited to N plus 1 and M plus 1. That is the first condition. If you want to make a baseline surface into the shape of a bezier surface. So this is an application of changing the surfaces from one surface to another surface. So this is an example of control points again. The surface is of which order? Whether it is third order, fourth order, or fifth order. Any idea? See, the number of control points here, N and M, is going to define. And whatever the polygon value for the matrix form is in two directions, it is the order. This is given in fact in the last line here. The surface is fourth order in U direction, but it is third order in the V direction. This we cannot achieve in the case of bezier surface. This you have directional controls independently in two directions, right? You are giving, you are seeing the set of points on the surface of your baseline curve. It looks very similar to your bezier surface control points, but when we actually look out the answers, the U direction is not the same as the V direction. Since the curve is open uniform, why we call it as a open uniform? Baseline is basically open uniform. So the knot vector, or what we call as the knot value, will have the multiplicity at the end equal to the order of the baseline. That means when it becomes just like the cubic bezier, like M and N equal to 3, the U and V directions will get 3 values. So you have a case here, the representation of the each and of the control points can be defined in this manner also. This P, small p over in the middle, the equation here, is a set of points here, like here. Now, to represent it, simply we have put the matrix P. The number of knot vectors elements along U and V directions is 3, because in U direction it is 3. And the other direction it is 4. So So number of not vector elements is A along U, and it becomes the 3 plus 3 plus 1 equal to 7 along B. So the what do you mean by the not vectors again? It is the value of the control point in vector form, just the vector form, that's all. So which is defined here as n of u with the suffixes not comma k, 1 comma k, up to the value of n comma k. And in the other direction, not comma l, 1 comma l, up to m comma l. So you can have two different direction variations. So the not vector is going to be crucial in the definition of this line surfaces here. As we see in the case of VCS surfaces, the individual values of U and V. Not vector can be independently changed in the U direction, and not vector value can be independently changed in the V direction. So it can be different vectors also, it need not be equal because it is having local control. Further, these values can be seen for changes in the individual points, and the range of U can be defined between n minus k plus 2. Right, if you want to have local control by properly adjusting to the not values, the U or V limit is not up to unity. It is not BCS surface at least. So we can have any value. And the center point will have parametric value of U equal to 0.5 and V equal to 1. Why we call it a parametric? In fact, parametric operation has used this second to the BCS surfaces. And wherever it is not possible to use BCS surfaces, we have to go for this kind of baseline surfaces. Now, it is not unity, so it can have any value. So we can customize a general equation for this particular conditions, like any local point is to be defined, or like P of U and V, given value of U and V. You can have general form of the not vectors in the k direction and l directions. When we substitute any value for U and V independently, we get the equations in Cartesian form like this. So this is an example. Now, for the incorporation of the values 0.5 in U and 1 in V, you get an answer like 0, 1, 0. What does that mean? It's a node or a control point which is along y direction. It is not along x direction, not in y direction. The value of the point is lying in the y direction, and this represents one of the points here. If you want, you can do some additional values here. Again, 4 polygon is given. The surface is fourth order in both parametric direction. But whereas in the earlier case we have seen, this is here in this screen, this is not fourth order in both direction. This is given fourth order in only U direction, and it's third order in V direction. So you can get so many equations like this as a final form. Then we talk about the characteristics, which is nothing but the characteristics of BCS curves itself. Surface will interpolate only 4 control points, as in the case of this BCS surfaces. It can interpolate the given characteristic polyhedron points. And again, it conforms to the convex hull property for topological arrangement. It uses a special basis function, which is distinct from the BCS surfaces. There we call it to be coefficient. Here it is a basis function, and it is not using any factorial form. it provides that. That is the only reason we have the local control, and that is the reason behind having independent control in each directions of you and me. The shape of this surface can be modified either by changing some vertices of the polyhedron or by keeping the polyhedron fixed and specifying multiple coincident points of the same vertices. Again, for manipulating the surfaces, you have first to change some of the vertices. It is not going to affect global control. If you want to affect any overall changes, you need to do at least more than one time, because it is not like a BCS surface, like when you move one of the control point, the entire surface will move. Because it is independent in two directions, you need to do it at least two ticks on the screen, so that you will have some changes in the surface as you decide. By doing so, you can keep some of the polyhedrons fixed to keep it restricted on one surface, aligned to one surface, depending upon our earlier control point positions, continuity of the surface with respect to the other attaching surfaces. We can keep polyhedrons fixed, and we can also keep some of the points as coincident points. The coincident points will help us to reduce the burden of controlling more number of control points. We can keep as many points other than the two air control points in a BCR curve also to be fixed. Right? A closed baseline surface can be generated by closing its polyhedron or choosing a coincident control point, like we have seen in the fifth point. For controlling the surface, we can do it most probably in the open manner, because it is an open curve, open polynomial curve. But when we want to decided to be closed surface, it can be also affected. It has local control capability, which is the distinct capability. And the degree of surface will be independent to the number of data points used in both directions, in U and V directions, unlike in the BCS surface. So if you want to have more control over the surface, while you are restricted for your control in the BCS surface, you will opt out for this B-spline surface. So I have one more slide to show about the surface patches. Before going into this introduction to patches, why we require patches in surfaces? Any idea? Any guesses? We can develop surfaces, whether it is ruled surface or anything like that.
General degree of surfaces.
General surfaces can be created as per our wish. Like the circumferential surfaces of any regular solids can be fine. Why we need to go for the case of BCS surface, this line or termite based curves is only to exploit the general curves. Okay. Now this patches. Any idea, sir? Patches. Why we require patches for surfaces? While I am generating some surface model, I may not be able to exactly fill up some new contours. There may be some unattached surfaces. Like we take the example of this room. If I am going to patch it with a set of surfaces, I am taking a screen like thing, like just like a screen. I am attaching this particular wall, and I am attaching something as a surface to this particular wall, and I am also attaching something to the bottom of the floor. The corner is left unattended. The corner position, corner may not get attached to the adjacent surface. So inevitably when you define a surface, the corners of 3 or 2 or even 4 set of surfaces where they join together is not going to be fully forming, but you have some white space over there. It is topologically narrow. When we see something as a surface, it should be not having any white space. I understand what is the meaning of this white space. When we attach something like sheets, this boundary of the sheets will inevitably not join together at one point. Even a single point is missed, then it gives rise to some gap. You can just think of this like a tarpaulin sheet is being made with individual set of sheets. So we have some use of these patches. So like if the shirt is a little bit torn, the tailor will take a piece of cloth and attach it so that it will not be seen as an empty space. So like here, we also have some patches to be arranged, because when we develop it later as a solid model, when we see for its integrity as a useful surface, this gaps in the surface will give rise to topological error. So one person, Coombs, he has developed this specific patches, and in his name itself this patches have been named. Any kind of ruled or locked surface can be generated by joining corresponding points on two spaces, like rails. We are going to see here. This first rail is defined by QI, and second rail is GI. It's again a curve. QI is a separate rail, GI is a separate rail, and the joining points of GI and QI is defined by U equal to 0, U equal to 0 minus 1, something like that. You can change this individual values so that this surface can be ruled. You know what is a ruled surface? When we open a cylinder, what we get as the vertical lines or the connection between the number of points on the bottom circle to the top circle in a vertical manner. These are the rules. So in the rule, in the typical ruling ruled surfaces, we get something like this. And in a general curve, it may be independent curve, independent curves. So generally, we name it to be QU and GU. It may be any curve, right? So the rulings are generators. We can see the use of generators in computer graphics for imaginary lines connecting the vertex, the top apex to the bottom control points. Is there any number of values for this generators? Is it like fixed like 10 or 20? It can be anything. So it is up to the equation to pick the numbers. But in parameter values, the U can be 0 and 1, as we see in the case of curves. Here we have the introduction to rulings. Now, when we take only one rule here for U equal to UI for the point on the road, called B of UI comma B for two directions, the value of B is 1 from the value of B equal to 0. Means B is changing from 0 in its direction to 1 in its direction, whereas the value of U is something called as UI. Now we can write it in the polynomial form for ruled surface, general ruled surface for these conditions. The individual polynomial equation may be GI, the first surface, that is where u equal to 0 is starting and u equal to 1 is ending. That is the first one. And in addition to that, the qi, which is the top rail, minus the value of the gi in its parameter form. The v is the parameter along ruling direction, because v is equal to some value, v is changing, u is the generating term. Right? Again, for generalizing this equation given above, we can expand the gi terms and the v terms, and v is going to be defined for the functions of q, u and gu, which are nothing but two rays here, q, gu and qu. Right. And it is simplified, we have limitations of u between 0 and 1 and v between 0 and 1. And now, the previous surfaces are finite number of data points required to generate respective surfaces. What surfaces we have generated? It's a ruled surface. It is between two rails, q and gi. The directions of u and v decide about the total shape of this patch. In cone surface patch, we have a transfinite interpolation. We have to distinguish now this peculiar Coons patch, which is able to patch up a gap in the set of surfaces now, which indicates that Coons scheme interpolates to an infinite number of data points. That is the requirement. When the variable is requirement to go and attach to the nearest point, it has to have the capability. So, infinite number of data points, earlier described with transfinite interpolation, is the capability of the Coons patch. Suppose you are doing it on the screen, we won't feel like this in number of points are hundreds or 200 or anything like that. We just click on the empty space for a generation of this Coons patch, and automatically, with the capability of infinite number of data point generation, this surface is just generated with an immediate availability of the control points. Right? So, to generate the Coons patch, we first require an already existing number of control points or already existing surfaces nearby. Now, the Coons patch job is to just fill up the gap. Coons patch is just to intended to do the job of filling up the patch. That's why it is called a patch. And parametrically, we can see that u and v direction, it is represented by the parametric space from 0 and 1. And in Cartesian space, again, it is the value of v defined for u alone, v alone, taken in order, like u is varying, v is 0, and the second set, value of u is kept 1 and v is kept 0, and third, u is changed and v is kept as 1, and the other one is u is kept 0 but v is changed. So this will define a Cartesian space. We want to know how much of variations are happening in the individual directions of this u and v. Two ruled surfaces connecting may be in superposition, that means they may be coinciding. They connecting two pairs of boundary curves, and they may satisfy the boundary curve conditions and produce the Coons surface. This is the final formation of the curve. So how you are able to determine that Coons patch is able to satisfy our requirement is like superposition of the two ruled surfaces. What two ruled surfaces? It may be the set of curves we have seen, like gi, ui, and connecting the two pairs of boundary curves will satisfy, that is a guarantee by Coons, like I will make a patch with respect to the earlier available control point. So this is the possibility of forming the surface. Like, this Coons patch is for the rural surface 2 and rural surface 1, and we superimpose both, we get a resulting surface. So this is just like already exists, there is some surface is existing. I am going to fill up something as a common surface between these two, and with the help of that I am going to get a patch. When we see the first ruled surface, it is defined for the polynomial P1 in terms of U and V, a separate curve which is given in red color, and the green color, the second ruled surface is the second, second set of control points, differently defined. But when these two can be superimposed, that is the requisition here, that's the requirement here. When these two surfaces can be superimposed, then automatically I will get something called a patch. And what we have as a resulting number of control points is defined as a as you can say in set theory, common points between these two. Common points as the vertex points, and a new set of control points is defined. So Coons has made a exploitation of already existing. The only thing he has done is superimposing, the possibility of superimposing two surfaces in order to satisfy some requirement. So if you see something as a surface in two directions, two different places, when we have the meeting up of these two surfaces as a net value of these two surfaces, we can get a single surface. That is the meaning of Coons surface. And accordingly you will get equations in two forms, because it is essentially defined by two different surfaces which are going to be superimposing. So you will have to describe the Coons patch in two equations now, for the first generating surface and second generating surface. Now you have equation just like this. These here are these lines, the surfaces. Again for U and V, with respect to the control points, values of U and V, we can define it to be a BCS surface or this plane surface. Any kind of surface can be used. Now by expanding again, we can rewrite in these two forms. Adding the two equations, we will get simply this form. This is a simple form of this Coons patch. I will get a resultant polynomial equation in terms of U and V for individual generating surfaces, basic input surfaces of first surface and second surface. The resultant surface can again be expanded in the bigger form here, like here. When we get some particular equations, when we substitute for the end point, so V is equal to 0, when V is equal to 0, we can assume that the number of terms can be reduced, and we get a simpler form of this curve. And again, when we substitute V equal to 1, we get a different form. And this is simply written for P of U comma 0 and P of U comma 1. These are special cases of these equations. The correct equation for Coons patch, we require extra terms. But these extra terms are defining the boundaries of the unwanted surfaces. Where we require this Coons patch, wherever we don't have continuity of the surfaces. When the continuity of the surface is defined by first surface and as well as the second surface, we can automatically get the Coons surface. But the extra terms are defined, that is for the third polynomial expression, which is embedded in the surface equation itself. The extra surface can be defined with the linear interpolation in V direction. It is taking only the parameter V to be changed. So any correction surface or error surface is PD. Definitely it requires only two surfaces. But if you want some alterations to be made, it is the third surface which is coming into picture, because the resultant surface is not affected. It is only a net outcome of these two surfaces. But independently you want to have control over the surface, then you need to incorporate one more polynomial which is given by P3 here. Now we can completely have control over the batch itself. The batch assumes that the continuity of the surfaces are there. Then this character surface, when it is incorporated, it will give away any chances of correcting any changes or making any individual changes to the patch surface itself. So that defines the use of the surface to the fullest extent. So total you have P1, P2 and P3. But generally we can write this Boolean sum of P1, P2, P3 as P1 plus P2 minus P3, because this P3 is only a fraction surface. It may be negated. As a general form, the Boolean sum is represented like this. So connecting four boundary curves, the Kuhn surface equation is again represented here. What are the disadvantages of this Kuhn's patch? Main drawback is bilinearly blended, because already it is defined by one surface in one direction, other surface in the other direction. The direction is not so important. The values of U and V is important here. Already it is restricted by two surfaces, so it is linearly restricted in two directions, that is given by bilinearly. And the meaning of blended here is when we have combination of these two surfaces as a superimposing, only we get this resulting patch. So it provides no changes to be made unless you have a correction polynomial. This P3 imposed on it. Applying Kuhn's patch may just be a resultant of the two superimposed surfaces, nothing else than that. You cannot have any variations. The incorporation of your correction surface, you can make a variation. So it's simple to apply. When it gets this third surface also, it can have the continuity to be increased for linear changes. So C1 means what? Any slope changes we can make. We can change the slope to certain degree. But it only provides a location in its fundamental purpose. You can change the location of the patch in its primary applications. I think I concluded on time. If you got any doubts regarding this, I will leave the slides on the screen itself. Anyway, at the end of this 7 days also you can collect like this. If you have specific requirement like we need additional problem or anything, more explanation, we can always give it as an input. Not only for this session I am telling, any kind of topic you are listening to, you can leave your comments at the end of the session so that we can add up the material, just experience you are getting together, so that your requirements will be getting fulfilled. If you have any requirement, you can leave to the coordinator, so it can be fulfilled by the end of this 7 days FTP program. I thank you for your cooperation.
Keyboard and mouse entry will give you an easier interface. Most importantly, it is user friendly. So, my colleague here, Mr. Vigneshwaran, is going to give you insight of how this AutoCAD is going to be. And later on, we will be working on the software and having some exercises. Now, I give the stage to Mr. Vigneshwaran.
So, it is user friendly compared to the PROE CADIA. And the SOLIDWORKS. So these are things that we can use the 2D sketches. Okay. So for compared to the things, the AutoCAD is still very user friendly for the 2D, but not for the 3D. Okay, 3D object is somewhat difficult to compare to the SOLIDWORKS, CATIA as well as PROE. So basically introduction we are going for the 2D sketches. Okay. So first of all, there is a software which is user friendly to the human beings, it is the for the mechanical as well as the civil. Okay. So for the construction everything, first initially it is done in the 2D. So then only they are going for the 3D sketches. Okay. So you try to draw the projects. Okay. For the 2D sketches, what are the figures if you understand, you can write about it. You just draw the models. If you want the model object, means I will give it there. Okay, you draw whatever. So then I have to give the more points of the autocad. So in the autocad, we can use about 14 decimal points. So that is, we can get the more accurate value compared to the all the softwares. Compared to all the ones, we can use the 14 points. Okay, in the same way for drawing that, we can have the three coordinate system: relative, absolute, and polar. So I think you all will do so. That is the relative, absolute, and polar. So these things with the polar, sorry, relative, absolute, and polar. The polar quantity, this is the using the angle. So in the first, we are using the angle. So for the angle system, we are using the counterclockwise. Okay, so from initially it is going to be using the angle 30 degree, means we can use the counterclockwise direction. Okay, so similarly absolute and relative. Okay, relative means that is the first. Absolute means we are fixing the initial origin, x and y. So it is the absolute. Okay, it is the absolute value. So from the corner, from the reference axis only we are going to draw. So if this relative means if you are drawing a line, the another point will be taken as a object. That is the relative coordinates. That is the two things difference. So we can draw either by relative or absolute or polar. So these are the three things used in the AutoCAD system. I give the models if you want, or else you can draw the anything. If you want any 20 person, you can ask. I am also a new beginner, but I have taken the lab for the first year students. That's why I am taking.
Let's go.